Dear Bungie, or is it Dear 343 or Dear Microsoft? I'm gonna go with Bungie since they established the lore. This was kind of awkward. Do I have a joke for that to, kick up the pacing? Anyway, 343 Bungie Soft, I'm writing to you today on behalf of Clyde Marshall, who wants to know about your Halo rings. Are you ready? I'm ready. Take a deep breath. Bungie Soft 3, your Halo rings make no goddamn sense. But why don't they make sense? That's the real interesting question. More interesting than I initially realized, in fact. You see, originally I was planning on ripping the Halo rings apart for being completely unrealistic ring worlds, with only tangentially mentioning how they work as galaxy erasers as an afterthought. But then, as I read more, the afterthought started to become less afterthought-y. And as I read more and more and more and got deeper and deeper into the problem of Halo rings, I started to get more and more lost to my feelings of Inquisition. Halo ring worlds became the afterthought. And now, they're not even a thought in my mind at all. All that matters is the answers. And the answers? They are fucking terrifying. Most of the lore for the Halo rings was established in the very first Halo game, Halo Combat Evolved, which was a revolutionary game in its own right. In fact, I wasted hundreds of hours playing co-op Halo in high school. I have the story practically ingrained in my memory. Here's the setup for those of you who may have forgotten or otherwise don't know. There's this terrible alien race known as the Flood. They're basically space zombies meets the Zerg. Space herpes. Like herpes, the Flood is annoying and notoriously difficult to get rid of. So difficult, in fact, that these other aliens, called Forerunners, kind of think of them as being like the Protheans in Mass Effect. These Forerunners built giant ring worlds capable of wiping out the Flood. Well, sort of. Actually, what they're designed to do is to wipe all sentient life off the face of the galaxy. Since the galaxy is kind of big, they built 12 of these things. Each one has an effective radius of 25,000 light years. The entire galaxy is estimated at being roughly 100 to 180 light years wide, so this math actually checks out pretty well. There are only 7 left by the start of Halo 1, but that's alright. 7 is more than enough. So, to summarize, the Flood is bad, gotta kill the Flood. Turns out, they're hard to wipe out, so instead, Halos kill their food, which is any life over a certain biomass. Each Halo has an effective radius of 25,000 light years. You with me so far? Good. The first thing I thought of was gamma radiation, because, well, gamma radiation is absolutely terrible for life. I covered this a bit in my fan theory video about Fallout and Skyrim being in the same universe, but the long and short of it is that gamma radiation is a form of electromagnetic radiation characterized by an incredibly high frequency. It's the kind of radiation created during nuclear fusion and fission, like when bombs detonate. Remember that for later. It's gonna be important. Anyway, gamma rays penetrate human bodies and cause damage on a cellular level all the way through your body. They are cataclysmic to our internal organs in sufficient doses, creating permanent negative health effects even at low exposure and outright death in high doses. In fact, Halo lore seems to support gamma radiation as a source, as the wiki mentions it being radiation that targets the nervous system. Now, most radiation doesn't center on a particular system, but as the Halos aren't fully understood, that's all right. So, gamma radiation. Gamma radiation travels at C, which is the smarty pants science talk for the speed of light. You see it occur in formulas like Einstein's famous mass energy equivalence formula, E equals mc squared. So right away, you see a problem with this whole 25,000 light year thing. Light years are a distance described as the distance light in a vacuum covers in a year. So if I shine a flashlight at you from one light year away, you'll finally see the beam 365 days later. So gamma rays, traveling at the speed of light, are gonna take over 25,000 years to do their job. Not that that necessarily makes Halos that much less terrifying. Having inescapable deadly doses of radiation inching towards you at the speed of light has an incomprehensible, ethereal, Lovecraftian horror to it. But sufficiently advanced societies with faster-than-light traveling capabilities would have time to prepare. Luckily, the Halo universe has something called slipstream space, which can save any writer from the confines of modern science and consequences. Normally, occupants of the Halo universe use this for faster-than-light travel, but apparently the Halo devices are capable of firing into slipstream space and therefore circumvent the whole speed of light thing. Whatever, I just I'm too tired to rant about this. So we'll ignore the whole problem with light speed, but a single halo still has to output enough energy to cause cataclysmic damage to organisms in a 25,000 light year range. Speed may be circumvented, but energy requirements aren't. And in order to figure that out, we have to figure out how powerful gamma radiation has to be right at the 25,000 light year radius. From there, we can work our way back. But that's impossible, right? I mean, we don't have any real life analog for this sort of thing that we can do the math for. Turns out, yes, we do. Enter the most terrifying thing to enter the list of catastrophic things that could ruin our days after supervolcanoes. Gamma ray bursts. Gamma ray bursts are created when supermassive stars go supernova and send out jet bursts of extremely potent radiation. The first one was detected in 1967 by a satellite the United States put into orbit because it was the Cold War and they were paranoid that Russia would be doing secret nuclear weapon tests in space because whatever, that's just what people were worried about back then. So it turns out that occasionally our planet is bombarded by super deadly gamma radiation from dying stars, so why are we still here? Well, for a few reasons. One, these stars are very, very far away. Most of the time, actually, they're in entirely different galaxies, which is good because these bursts tend to be immensely powerful. Two, our atmosphere is actually pretty good at filtering out, or attenuating, gamma radiation. It hits the upper limits of our atmosphere and gets scattered and turned into ultraviolet radiation. All in all, about only 0.2% of the total strength of gamma radiation reaching our planet makes it down to the ground in the form of ultraviolet radiation. But a sufficiently powerful gamma ray burst that's close enough could actually cause damage on levels that we can't even imagine. In fact, it's theorized that gamma ray bursts may have been responsible for a couple mass extinction events in our history. Astrophysicist A.L. Mellett actually did the math on how damaging various gamma ray bursts could be to our planet, depending upon their strength and distance from us. He figured out that the average supernova releases 500 triticillion watts over 10 seconds. Those of you that watched my plasma rifle video may remember that watts are simply joules per second. So for the sake of simplicity, I'm just gonna do everything else in the video in joules. Anyway, 500 triticillion watts over 10 seconds amounts to 5 quaterdecillion joules. A.L. Mellett calculated that the average supernova releasing 500 quaterdecillion joules of energy at 700 parsecs, or just over 2200 light years, would be utterly disastrous for life on Earth. Should a gamma ray burst from a collapsing supermassive star a mere 2200 light years away slam into us, the gamma rays would punch straight through the outermost layers of the atmosphere and dump directly into our stratosphere, also known as where most of the ozone layer is. It's here that the gamma rays would finally almost entirely attenuate and scatter. Luckily, only 0.2% of the energy ever actually reaches the surface in the form of ultraviolet radiation. Unfortunately, we'd be getting bathed with 40 times more ultraviolet radiation than the sun outputs. Plants, people, animals, none of us were designed to handle that kind of radiation. Almost everything that's outside and unsheltered would die from acute radiation poisoning and burns. Even animals in the ocean are unsafe, at least the ones that dwell in shallower water. These gamma rays would only be hitting half the planet, luckily, but just like that, nearly half of all life on Earth would be shut off like a light switch. Unfortunately, it doesn't end there. While gamma radiation was attenuating, that is, getting weaker in the stratosphere, it wasn't just doing nothing. It was ionizing nearby molecules and atoms. This means that oxygen and nitrogen atoms would be splitting off from one another and recombining to form various nitrous oxides. The ozone layer is made of ozone, or three oxygen atoms bound together. This means all this gamma radiation would be completely destroying our ozone layer in favor of a nitrous oxide layer, which is significantly worse at filtering out harmful X-rays and ultraviolet radiation from our nearest nuclear fusion reactor, the sun. So while the immediate damage from a gamma ray burst impact will be on one side of the planet, our ozone layer will be immediately reduced by half across the entire planet. In fact, nitrous oxide is also known to passively eliminate ozone as well. So the long-term prognosis isn't good. As soon as daylight hits the nighttime side of the planet, everyone, from plants to animals, will be getting bathed in terrible ultraviolet radiation bad enough to completely disrupt our ecosystem and kill off whatever remains. As a somewhat ironic twist of fate, nitrous oxide also blocks visible light spectrums more than ozone does, which means that while our planet would be getting significantly more deadly ultraviolet radiation, our planet would actually plunge into a new, darker ice age. Basically, a powerful gamma ray burst from within our neighboring stars could turn our planet into a literal hell on Earth. Well, that's a cheerful thought. So, what does this mean for halo rings? How powerful of a gamma ray burst would a single halo ring need to unleash to get equally catastrophic results? Now, I know theoretically you might argue some folk could survive this, but remember, this is the strength at the very edge of a halo's effective radius. Given that there can be any number from 12 to 7 of these things going off means that there's gonna be a lot of overlap. Anyway, radiation decays as it moves outward. Luckily, the math for this is actually quite simple. I'm gonna save you a paragraph, but if you wanna check my math, I have a link in the description. When you plug all the numbers in the right place, you get the energy output of the original burst at the source of the halo, which amounts to 5.995 quindecillion joules. So, that's a big number. 5 followed by 47 zeros. I think it's the biggest number I've ever said on the show. Do I win something? But what does that actually mean in real life? Well, for one thing, it's over 100 times the power of the average supernova detailed by Mellett in his paper. So, it's ridiculous, right? Well, yes and no. What if I told you that, yes, while this number is absurdly huge, it's only registering at roughly 2/3 of the strength of the biggest explosion we've ever seen in our sky? You'd be right to think that this explosion is too intense for a supernova, but it's right in the sweet spot for something even more terrifying. Hypernovas. Novae. Whatever. You see, while supernovas are mostly understood, nobody's quite sure what causes hypernovas, since they don't seem to be a terribly frequent occurrence in our galaxy. The only reason this explosion we discovered didn't wreck our shit was because the exploding hypernova was over 12 billion light years away, leaving us safely out of range for its deadly effects. But what if one explodes in our galaxy? Well, hopefully one never does, but if it did, it would likely take thousands of years to reach us. Also, thankfully, supernovas and hypernovas don't seem to eject radiation out in a globe shape, but rather in a cone. So in order for our halo to work, it would have to be able to unleash more energy than our entire sun will have during its lifetime in a matter of seconds to create the biggest explosion we'd ever witness in our entire galaxy. If it found a way to disperse the energy evenly, everything in its path would be completely and totally fucked. Even at the furthest 25,000 light year point, our galaxy would be totally fucked. The most absurd notion is that somehow these halos have been fired before and are still around undamaged, as opposed to being sucked into the massive solar system sized black hole that they will have created by unleashing that amount of energy. Also, the flood would be totally unable to survive this, especially if they were anywhere near the initial blast. Things at the very edge of the effective radius are only mostly fucked, but anything well within this 25,000 light year radius is likely to be completely vaporized on the spot. Planets too! So, it turns out that your halos aren't really all that mathematically feasible as super weapons, Bungie Soft, but you know what? I honestly don't give a shit anymore, because now I fucking know that at any moment, deadly space radiation traveling at the speed of light could just slam into my planet without warning, wiping me and everyone I know and love off the face of the world in an instant, like a cold, unfeeling, uncaring hand of God. So, whatever. Do whatever you want. I'm gonna go get drunk. Sincerely, Austin. Thank you, everyone, for watching my Halo Science video on Halo Rings. This one was a challenge. I researched this one for like 4 days straight. I read several astrophysicist journals. It is incredibly complicated. If you like this channel, be sure to like and subscribe to it. I want to throw out a personal thank you to our Patreon supporters who are ever so patient with me when I make these videos. I send them notes and like, that looks fun. That looks cool, Austin. If you really like this show more than a like and subscribe could possibly articulate, then you could head over to our Patreon page and contribute whatever is feasible for you. We have some perks, and that's awesome. You can also follow me on Twitter, and ShoddyCast on Twitter. I never pimp our Twitters. We have Facebook, too. We have all the social medias. We don't have Instagram. I do have Instagram. You can find me. Some people have.
I'm babbling. Babblefish. That was tiring.